That's how 80s that music sounds. Is that Whitesnake playing in the background?
Yeah, great.
You think that's great?
I think they had a few good songs.
I think they had some good songs.
That was This Is Love, right?
Yeah. It's just they need to... I wish they would redo it. Like, do a Taylor's version of it to re-record the song and just strip out some of those drippy reverbs and all that stuff that just makes it anemic sounding to me. All right, so game one of the World Series. I was so excited for game one of the World Series because you guys know me. I love my baseball. I'm kind of a seam head. I'm just always talking baseball. And I've really followed the Rangers
since they moved from Washington.
Since they moved from Washington. That's what I was thinking
Wednesday.
Of.
Wednesday.
And I love it that
since Wednesday.
I love their players. I love
Don't go too deep.
The guys that they have.
The guys.
All the guys.
Generic. Adolis Haim.
No, come on. You know him better than that.
Bork.
Adolis Garcia.
Yep.
Corey Haim.
No.
Crispin Glover.
No.
God.
And all the rest. Max Scherzer. There you go.
Got one.
Good job.
Thank you. But anyway, excited about game one of the World Series. Unfortunately, it happened when a bigger event was going on.
A nap?
Much bigger than the World Series. And that is the arrival of the rock band Kiss in Fort Worth, baby.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Rock and roll all night, party every day.
That's right. I saw him post a picture from the concert on X, and that was the biggest non-disclosure that you didn't tell us you were going to see Kiss.
Huge. That's right. I went to go see Kiss. It was awesome, man.
I went to go see a joke band over the World
Series. Don't call it a joke band.
He just complained about Whitesnake.
Their music is very serious.
But now he's going to pump up Kiss.
Yes. Listen to this. It's awesome.
Let's reset the mics on those drums. We're going to talk production.
Hey, it's a natural. It's actually a band playing the song. That's good.
Yeah.
With Gene Simmons singing there. And, of course, they ended the show with this.
Got to.
Okay, in all honesty... All right, turn off this crap music, please. In all honesty, I went to the show, and I know that you hate Kiss. And they are in their 70s now.
I don't hate them. I just never got it. I just never got it.
They're in their 70s, but I wanted to go see them. My brother, who is a lifelong Kiss fan.
I mean, when
we were little kids, he got into Kiss. That double live album they had, I think somebody gave it to him for his birthday, and my mom took it back to the store because she was not going to allow him to be into Kiss. So he had to sneak off to his friend's house to watch Kiss. I mean, to listen to Kiss. And I mean, it was huge. So I went to the Kiss concert with my brother, which was awesome.
That's great.
And I have to say, Giorgio, I thought of you because I'm there watching them, and Paul Stanley talks like Mushmouth between songs. He's always trying to do this. You can't understand him.
Isn't that song pretty cool?
Pretty cool. Pretty cool song of a while.
Was it packed? It was.
Yeah, I looked to me like it was packed. Mm-hmm. I mean, there were a few empty seats, but I don't know whether those were closed off seats or not. But it was the greatest show I've ever seen because they have so many bits. And I had known that about them, but I just didn't put it together. So I was very pleasantly surprised. I hadn't watched any of the footage from this tour, and they swear this is their last tour ever.
Uh-huh.
This is about their 10th last tour ever. But now you figure Father Time is probably making this official for them.
Yeah.
I can't imagine them going much longer than this. So they had so much fire. The first three songs, I had a huge smile on my face because it was so over the top.
Just pyro everywhere.
Yeah, it's lasers and pyrotechnics, and and there's a huge snake on the stage that blows steam out all over the stage. It's just, it's over the top. It was wrestling meets rock and roll circus kind of feel, and just the spectacle of it was fantastic.
Yeah.
And you know the statement, "It's the greatest show I've ever seen," is a big statement.
It is, but I haven't seen as many shows as other people have.
You're just saying, like, presentation. You've never seen some sort of, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, musically, was it the greatest show? No. There was pointless guitar solos, and and that wasted a lot of time, and Paul needs to clean up his stage presentation. He doesn't need to talk so much between songs. And he doesn't need to do so much, you know, "How about this section, sing loud," and then that, you know, okay, we get it. It's, you can do a little bit of it, but it was too much of that. But it was all the elements that they had incorporated that made it so fun. The fire was just awesome. And then you had a thing where Paul Stanley, there's another stage at the other end of the stadium, a little smaller stage. And at some point he gets hooked into a trapeze and it just flies him out to this other stage. I mean, the dude's like 72 and he flew to the other stage. That was cool. Then they had these platforms that raise them way up into the air. That was cool. And then they had this thing towards the end that Gene Simmons got in, and I was on Gene's side. And he gets in there. There's this huge crane that swings him way out over the audience. So he came right by us, about 20 feet in front of us, waving at us.
That's got to be semi-dangerous, I would think.
I know, yeah. Gene is 74. And he's wearing those stupid dragon boots and bat wings and everything. And he's getting on a crane that swings him out, you know, 80 feet above the floor.
Yeah.
And fire shooting off all around him. And I mean, it was so over the top.
Does one dude still put lighter fluid in his mouth? And
Gene, yeah. He blew fire. He did the blowing fire gag.
Does he have the extra long tongue still?
Yes, has the extra long tongue. And he did his God of Thunder bass solo, which, have you ever seen that? So he gets out there on stage and it kind of all goes dark except for him. And then the camera's right up on him, and he has that demon look and everything, and he's looking at us and looking all startled that there's people out there. He looks like an animal is about to attack. And his bass has all this distortion on it, and he keeps playing it and everything. And as he keeps playing it louder and louder, and it starts going crazy, his eyes roll back in his head, and his mouth starts to open, and blood just starts pouring out everywhere.
That's awesome.
Yeah, and meanwhile, he's being raised up into almost the top of the stadium as the camera's on him, but he's at the top, just overwhelmed with bass power, blood pouring out of him.
People going crazy.
Just nuts. Yes, they're going nuts. It was awesome.
Maybe I got it wrong a long time ago. Maybe they are the greatest band ever, and I should have just embraced
it. It's such a party and just a spectacle. Yeah. And I had heard that about their shows, but I just wasn't expecting it.
How long ago did Ace Frehley and Peter Criss leave the band?
They left in early 80s, I would say 83.
Oh, wow. That
and then they tried to come back at some point, and they were still such F-ups that they had to kick them out again.
Okay.
It's like they just wouldn't practice. And, you know, Paul and Gene take that business seriously, whether you like their music or not. They're very serious about being business guys. And that the fans, they do have kind of a sacred relationship. Hey, the fans are coming to pay for a show. And when Peter Criss would get mad at the other dudes on stage, and he'd slow the song way down and then speed it real fast.
Really?
So he would mess with their stage show.
Wow.
And Paul Stanley's, you know, like, hey, no matter if you're pissed at me and Gene, we still got to go out there and do our jobs.
Yeah.
But anyway, so those guys got kicked out again. But the new guys, who, I say new guys, but they've been with the band for like 25 years now. They wear the same makeup.
Mm-hmm.
They wear the Ace Frehley makeup and the Peter Criss makeup. And Tommy, the guitar player that they have, he still has the Ace Frehley guitar that shoots fire at the end. So he does a big solo. He does a big solo, and at various points, it'll shoot a Roman candle out of it. He'll point it to some place on the stage. It'll shoot a Roman candle, and then there's a fake explosion as if part of the backdrop blows up. There was a spinning fire wheel that came out near the drum riser at one point. It's just shooting fire every which direction. Big pinwheel of fire. It's so stupid and over the top. It's so great.
I can't believe they haven't had a major mishap on stage with some sort of injury.
I want to say Gene has set his hair on fire several times.
Yeah.
Because he's wearing, you know, all sort of hairspray and product in that thing. And they're probably wigs now. I'm sure the guys are wearing wigs now. So, but it was fun.
But as you said, they're really smart business-wise. Like, they have different ways that you can meet the band and different price points.
It is the most commercialized show I've ever seen. Because you go on there and you look at the VIP experiences you can pay for. And a lot of bands are doing this now where you can buy different experiences with the band, you know, for the meet and greet afterwards. But Kiss has, like, I don't know, 6 levels of their meet and greet that you can do. You know, some include pictures, some include saying hi to the band, some include you just standing near them and getting a picture made, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And they're thousands of dollars. Then they also sell off, I think, every instrument that Paul and Gene play throughout the show. They'll switch guitars about 3 or 4 times. All of those are sold at the end of the show. The one that Paul Stanley bashes into a million pieces at the end of the show, that is also sold. So every part of it is a commercial venture for them.
Wow.
I know.
And I had another question.
Do I love you?
Did you think any of it was tracked?
Yeah, I think some of it was. You know, Paul Stanley's voice sounds trashed. Gene can still sing because he kind of had that voice anyway.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that several of Paul's songs, and maybe some of Gene's are too, tracked. I would say about at least 50, maybe 50-50.
And I don't have a problem with that.
But it seemed like they were playing live. Yeah. I mean, the instruments sounded live to me. It was just the vocals sounded like they had been sweetened a little bit.
You're a bass guy. Is Gene a good bass player?
He's okay. I mean, I think that the parts that he plays, like Rock and Roll All Night, I like that part. It's not hard, but it's good and tasteful and fits in the song.
Mm-hmm.
That boom, doom, 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 boom, doom, doom, doom.
What about the God of Thunder? It makes him, he plays so well, it makes him bleed out of his mouth.
Yeah, on God
it
of Thunder.
It must be good, yeah.
Yeah. God, that song is so great. So great when he played God of Thunder and did the bass solo. Well, so that was fun. And they had
disclosure.
And in the, I could see into the suite nearby us that had the Ranger game on. So I was following the Ranger game at the same time.
That's how you cover the Ranger
game. That's how I cover the Ranger game on Friday night. And the problem with Bruce Bochy is somebody needs to tell him his glasses are too small.
Look at his glasses.
They're
him.
Too small for his face. Him. He needs an optometrist to tell him that his glasses are too small.
Okay.
Because I think it's Jinx and the Rangers right now that he's wearing undersized eyewear.
All right, we'll get that message to him.
Uh-huh.
All right, Gordo, thanks. That's the Odex.
So I think it was it on Saturday or when Matthew Perry passed away, the famous Friends actor?
Friday or Saturday?
Saturday.
It was Saturday, and I saw a tweet. Someone said, RIP Matthew Perry. Well, anybody who's ever watched one of my Twitch streams knows that this is a common gag for the P1s that picked up on it after us, as they'll throw off the Twitch stream by saying RIP somebody, and it'll send me down a rabbit hole of trying to find out if they're really passed.
Hilarious line of humor, by the way, that you've captured over the years.
I thought the Matthew Perry one was somewhat believable, but kind of way far out there. You know, I was like, you should have chosen an older actor. And lo and behold, about an hour later, I look at the news and it was true. Matthew Perry, of Friends fame and of Muser's fame,
mm-hmm.
passing away at the age of 54, looks like he accidentally drowned in his hot tub at his home in Los Angeles. Now, the cause of death has been listed as deferred right now because they did the autopsy and then issued a deferred certificate. I'm sure they're going to wait for toxicology to find out if there was some contributing factor there.
So he just passed out?
Yeah, I guess so, or maybe slipped and hit his head. And then that caused him to go unconscious and go under the water? Don't know.
Maybe an OD?
I don't think you're allowed to say
with
that.
With his history?
I don't think you're allowed to say that.
He's written about it. He's talked about it.
Yeah, but that's his truth to tell. not yours.
I think it's a possibility.
Yeah, no, it is. I mean, anybody who has substance abuse issues, people wonder if they've relapsed and maybe he had taken something. But I also, you know, he didn't look, even though he was in rehab and had cleaned up, watching him talk was difficult.
Mm-hmm.
Because he still, there was still some, I don't know whether it's lingering effects from drug abuse or what, but his talking was kind of slowed and slurred somewhat. And maybe that was anti-anxiety medication he was on. I don't know. But he swore that he was clean and he'd really gotten into pickleball. I remember seeing him on the talk shows talking about pickleball and how that was his saving grace. And he's led a lot of people into sobriety by introducing them to pickleball to take up their time.
Mm-hmm.
And energy.
That was really sad.
And he had just come back from playing pickleball from a nearby club near his home. And he had returned home. And then he sent an assistant out to go. Sent the assistant out to pick up a new iPhone. And it was something else that they were supposed to get. Prescription glasses. That's it. And when the assistant returned home 2 hours later, found him floating in the jacuzzi.
Yeah.
So it was only a couple hours after he had returned from playing pickleball that this happened.
Hmm.
54 years of age. The first of the Friends cast members to pass away. And if you thought you were going to get Matthew Perry dying there for many years, everyone thought, well, it's going to be a drunk driving accident or it's going to be an OD or something like that. Wouldn't have predicted if it turns out that he just slipped in a jacuzzi and it being unrelated to anything. Just losing his balance.
Mm.
Although I've always had a bad feeling about me slipping and hitting my head.
Really?
Yeah, I've told this on the air before. I just have a lot of near misses. I have a nice... What was that out there?
I think
there?
That was a sneeze.
Tara
that was the loudest
sneezing.
Sneeze I've ever heard.
Out in the hallway, we heard it through a soundproof door. Well, that door doesn't shut all the way. But yeah, I'll be in the shower and I'll hit a slick patch and lose the balance. You mm-hmm. know, your heel slips for 6 inches, then you catch yourself.
Yeah.
And I go, oh, that's a close one. And it seems like I've had about 12 of those close ones before, of slipping but then catching myself.
Maybe you ought to resurface your shower.
Yeah, I know.
But artificial turf in there.
Can't they put the same stuff there they do the garages with now?
Imagine.
What's that stuff? You ever been in somebody's garage and they have the...
Floor coating?
Yeah.
Call Wellborn Garage or go to...
Yeah, they can put that in.
Can they do showers?
Probably.
They turn my garage? Can they turn my shower into a garage?
Probably. Little divider here.
Matthew Perry.
Top 5 worst guest in ticket history.
Huh.
See, I don't remember it like you guys do. I remember it was awkward.
It was terrible.
Really bad.
It was a terrible interview, and I was on one of my text chains the other day talking about this. Corby was also on it, and he said, that's so weird because we had him on too, and he was a terrible guest.
Really?
I think he's one of their 5 worst guests they've ever had on. Now, maybe he was battling substance abuse and all that.
And once again,
to
his family.
To the family.
But that
sorry, we didn't make the divider a little bit taller.
We did put out a divider, though.
Yeah,
but it was a real cheap one. It was that thing at the grocery store you put on the conveyor belt that still
it works.
Gets buried beneath groceries. And it's like, no,
that's
theirs.
That's mine.
Theirs. Mine are the tampons and the wine.
To the family.
Yes.
Sorry that he brought up tampons during this eulogy.
What's wrong with bringing up tampons?
You're obviously making a joke, and nothing's funny about this.
Right.
I wasn't making a joke. I support tampon products.
No, it was part of your punchline on divider humor. He passes away with a celebrity net worth of $120 million.
Yeah. Unmarried, too.
He never got married?
No. And, you know, it was really sad that he seemed like a guy who was really looking for a relationship and he wanted kids and all this kind of stuff and it never happened for him and he battled these... I mean, for one of our most successful Americans... Well, actually, he's Canadian, I think. But of all time, that you can still lead a emotionally, you're still a human, and you can have all that money, and you still find happiness elusive.
Yeah, doesn't matter.
He was both, by the way, born in the United States, but was also Canadian.
Okay.
I guess born to Canadian parents.
Yeah, he was a childhood friend of Justin Trudeau.
Really?
Yeah, he was. So that means Matthew Perry's never read the Constitution either.
Never understood it.
In some of these stories I was reading about what he wrote in his book in 2015 or something, did you read the bit about how badly he wanted to be famous?
Yes.
That was the only time that he ever prayed in his life. He got down on his knees and begged God to make him famous.
That's the part that Gordon highlighted. Yeah, I need to do that.
Now, at one time I thought that I wanted to be famous and then decided, I don't think it's as great as everybody makes it out to be. Sounds like a lot of hassle.
Mm-hmm.
The sweet spot, I guess, is being rich but not famous. And even that, I think you're better off being only slightly rich.
Yeah.
You don't need...
Not that everyone knows that you are.
Yeah, and you don't need God-like money to where you can just indulge your every worst desire and feed your laziness. You need a little bit of necessity in your life to keep yourself going.
Mm-hmm.
There is a sweet spot in there somewhere. But yeah, this guy made $1 million an episode, as did the rest of the cast in their final few seasons. And he had a few movies, and one of them was filmed here in Dallas. Matter of fact, I think it was the one that he went into his first big rehab, public rehab, while he was filming the movie here in Dallas. Was it Fools Rush In that was filmed in Dallas?
Maybe. 1997.
Because, and I may be out of my depth here, but I want to say that he showed up at Lakewood Landing one time.
Hmm.
Really?
My old home dive bar, yeah. But he filmed that with, was it Julia Roberts?
Looks like Selma Hayek.
Selma Hayek. There you go. There you go. His battle with substances, he said that he didn't remember 3 seasons of Friends because he was so wasted.
Wow.
He didn't even remember filming them, really.
He said he was taking 50 Vicodin a day.
55 Vicodin a day. Vicodin.
Unbelievable.
Wow. And he drank a lot. God. How does your liver survive drinking and that much Tylenol?
I don't know.
That's crazy. He also had his colon explode.
Hmm.
And he spent the past few years wearing a colostomy bag.
He did?
Yeah.
Mm. Wow.
He almost died after his colon exploded. They gave him like a 2% chance of living, and somehow he survived that to write a memoir that only came out last year. And he became obsessed with Batman in his later days, too. And his last 7 posts on social media had something to do with Batman. He called himself Matt Man.
Okay.
And his very final post on Instagram, did you see that?
No.
No.
It's him sitting in that hot tub overlooking L.A. And it said, "So warm, swirling water surrounding you feels good." And he signed it Matt Man, and that was his final post. It was him inside that jacuzzi.
Well, that's weird. I'm looking at his Twitter feed. He posted a couple of times last week, and those were the first 2 posts since late last year.
Mm-hmm.
So he got active and then passed away.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, since all of time has already been done, and there is no such thing really as time, we're just experiencing slices of the time cube as it goes by, so it has the appearance of time. I think that our subconscious already knows all the future. So when you see people start getting active like that, their subconscious knows the end is coming.
Wow, man.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Check into it.
Okay.
Look it up.
Right.
Look up the cheese
under
theory
what?
Of time.
Cheese?
I just made that
Look
up.
Look under cheese?
You know who his stepfather was? I didn't know this.
Who?
That Keith Morrison.
The broadcaster from
the
NBC?
Creepy Elder Ken doll.
Yeah.
Not
I mean, no.
He does.
I don't mean that it is negative.
Dateline, I
to
think.
To Ken, yes.
Hmm.
That's his stepfather.
Huh.
His regular parents, they split up when he was, I think, a baby. But his mom was a... worked for Justin Trudeau's dad, who was also, I think, the Canadian Prime Minister. Anyway.
Matthew Perry.
Matthew Perry.
It's a big one.
Is it?
Yeah.
Do you have to debate that one?
Huge.
And he was missing a finger. Did you notice that?
No.
Yeah, a lot of people didn't realize that when Friends was on the air. But I had already learned about it, you know, later on after Friends. I certainly became aware of it. It was his middle finger. He's missing like the last half of his finger. And he had some accident when he was a kid.
Did they have to hide it like they in MASH had to hide Gary Berghoff's small arm?
You know, that's what I was thinking. I thought, well, that's probably why no one really noticed during Friends, is because they hit it all the time. And then when I went back a couple years ago and started trying to rewatch Friends, I was like, oh, you can clearly see the...
Really?
Yeah, the short finger.
Hmm.
In a lot of scenes. There it is. How did no one pick up on that? And I think it was because... And remember when Friends got popular streaming again a few years ago when they released it and everybody started watching? All of a sudden, the internet chatter about his finger cropped up. Like, almost immediately. People were going, I didn't know Matthew Perry had a malformed finger. Hmm. And... I think that the explanation is because back then we were watching in ultra low def.
Yeah.
And so you just couldn't tell.
I was just about to ask if maybe it was HD that.
Yeah. And then when HD reruns come about, everybody's like, oh my goodness.
So I'm looking at a picture of it and it's not that obvious. It's his middle finger, but it just looks a little shorter than the others. Like, look at that.
Yeah.
Like there's a scene from Friends and he's got his hand on somebody's shoulder. It's hard to tell. It's not like he's missing most
half
of the finger.
Of it,
I don't know, though.
Okay. I withdraw the last comment.
So there you have it. And then one other note that came down over the weekend that was very big news was the suspect in the killing of the 18 people in Massachusetts that also injured 13 others at the bowling alley and then that bar. And then he goes on the run. They did find him dead of a... self-inflicted gunshot wound on Friday.
Well, it went longer than I predicted, but the ending was what I predicted.
Looks like he went to a recycling center where he used to work, and that's where he ended his own existence.
Hmm. Is that a statement that he believes in the afterlife?
Or that he belongs in a landfill?
One of the two.
I don't know what happened there, but yeah. So that is the ending of that story. Okay, birthdays. In honor of Matthew Perry, I'm doing birthdays today.
Cheap.
So cheap.
He's going to do it anyway.
Henry Winkler is 78.
Greatness.
Our buddy, we just saw him a couple months ago.
We just had dinner with him.
Yeah.
Out in Malibu. That makes it sound like such high rollers.
We had sushi with him.
We had sushi with Henry Winkler in Malibu.
He was two rooms over from us.
Yeah, but details, same place. Details.
Still.
Andrea Mitchell, 77, TV journalist.
Still going.
Timothy B. Schmidt of the Eagles. And Poco. I get corrected on it when I say it.
He was
so
great.
Whichever way is the right way, that's the way I go with. He's 76. He sang,
I can't tell you why.
Hungry, love will keep us
alive.
Yeah,
but I can't tell you why it's better.
Harry Hamlin, 72. World's sexiest man.
Okay.
Was he at some point?
Kevin Pollak is 66. He does impersonations and stuff. Gavin Rossdale of Bush is 58. Used to be married to the Gwen Stefani.
Yep, they have kids together.
Cassidy Osborne of She Daisy, 47. Dave Valley is 63.
Former...
Dave.
Ranger?
Yeah.
I think
Ranger
so.
Ranger catcher? Valley?
Broadcaster also.
Oh, yeah, with the Mariners, right?
And the Rangers.
And turning 75 today is the guy who I had my first childhood baseball glove, was his signature model, or his name was on it.
Who?
Mickey Rivers.
The great John Mickey Milton Rivers.
Rivers. That is a cool name, Mickey Rivers.
Yes. I loved Mickey Rivers.
Yeah. Was he left-handed? Because my glove was a left-hander's glove, so.
He may have been a switch hitter.
As am I.
But in the field, he may have been left-handed. I love the way he twirled the bat at the plate.
Yeah.
God, I love Mickey Rivers.
A lot of funny sayings.
Well, he's 75 today.
All right, happy birthday, Mick the Quick. That is Muse 7th. But first, joining us on the Ticket Hotline is the owner and GM of the Dallas Cowboys. Here to talk about the big win over the Rams, we say good morning to Jerry Jones. How are you?
Good morning, football.
Good morning.
5-2, baby. 5-2.
Not bad.
I love it, and I do. And it was a game that got so out of hand, we got to see two Coopers and one Cup. That's my favorite.
Yeah, I guess we did.
I love it. It's like I always say, you know, whenever we see Cooper Rush out there, it's either really good or really bad.
Yeah.
And this time it was really good.
Really good.
I do feel bad that Matt Stafford hurt his hand.
Yeah.
You never like to see that unless you're me with no soul who just wants to win football games.
You don't care how it happens.
Don't care. And I was talking to old A-Rod before the game. Did y'all see that?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, y'all friends?
Well, I don't know about friends. He's a he's just a self-involved giant wad of ass, in my opinion. But he was wanting me to invest in a bunch of oxygen bars and ultra lounges and all that stuff that he's interested in.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking of douche-adjacent humans like A-Rod, don't you think old Sean McVay looks less like an NFL head coach, more like one of them Silicon Valley douche biscuits trying to fund some app-based smart home rideshare internet startup?
Maybe.
Yeah, I can see that.
Something about his face. I just can't stand it.
Really?
Yeah, I just want to go up to him after the game with a Lady Gillette and just shave off that ridiculous internet influencer beard he's working on.
A Lady Gillette?
Yeah, don't worry about that.
We did honor one of our own yesterday.
Yes.
We inducted Marcus Aikman into the Rings of Honor.
Should we correct him?
You messed it up again.
And I want to say that I don't appreciate getting booed from the Cowboy of Hands yesterday.
Yeah, that was too bad, I guess.
I mean, I gave them 3 Super Bowls, giant-ass stadium, 43-20 victory yesterday, and they booed me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's rude. That's rude. They're lucky I don't use them all as organs to keep me alive for another 1,000 years.
All of them.
And it's been 28 years, Jerry.
Well, that's all right. Just average them out. We're fine.
I mean, heck, the Rangers have now gone to 3 World Series in 14 years.
Well, just they won one?
No, they haven't won one.
I'd rather win 3 Super Bowls than just go to 3 World Series.
All right.
Okay.
Fair point.
Got them there.
Scoreboard. Scoreboard. Hey, Stephen and Jerry Jr. are planning on going as Travis Kelce and Taylor Swift for Halloween.
They don't need to go as anything.
Who's going
to
be who?
I'm not sure. I'm not sure. I told them I thought it was stupid. There's lots of kids going to be doing that. They need to go as a couple that has like a long history, a long love affair that lasts and stands the test of time.
Like who?
Robert Kraft and his massage therapist.
All right. Would you stop it?
You got a crafty yet, George?
No.
You ain't lived till you got a crafty.
All right.
But I'm trying to convince Stephen and Jerry Jr. to go as Dumb and Dumber. You know, Lloyd and Harry?
Right.
Perfect for them. Perfect.
Maybe they will.
I'm wanting to get Halloween over with so we can get to Thanksgiving.
Yeah? Why is that?
I'm ready to see that American Institution Dolly Parton perform at halftime.
Oh, I bet you are.
Dancing around there with her big old grandma gritties, dancing all over the God's green.
Jerry.
Singing Jolene.
Now, that's a show there.
Aren't you looking forward to that?
Well, I guess.
Them elderly chesticles flopping up and down all crazy like an inflatable car wash man.
I was hoping for Dua Lipa, but I guess it'll be all right.
You're going to get duo something. Duo floppies you're going to get. I'm telling you, seeing her out there, that may be enough to give me a half chub.
Okay, gosh, Jerry, we're on
Jerry,
the air.
Stop it.
Jean may finally get her wish, and we'll finally have a lovemaking session done in with me apologizing and blaming stress.
Oh, jeez. You tell us way too much.
You know, Dolly Parton's on my official free pass list.
Wow.
Oh, really?
Yeah, the only official one. You know, I have two of them. There's the free pass list that Gene signs off on, and there's the free pass list I keep to myself.
Right.
I keep it in my front breast pocket. Kind of scratch off names and add them as soon as they come up.
That one's pretty long, too.
Hey, how big of a teat holder do you think Dolly has to wear?
Probably as many D's as you can come up with.
I know, man. Just one half of her milk hammock has to be about a 44 quintuple F. You're right, George.
I'm okay.
All right, go football.
All right, go football. We'll see you. There goes Jared.
Thank you, Craig. A few notes before we go to the phones for Monday morning quarterbacking. Another Hollywood death, certainly not as big of a name as Matthew Perry, but Richard Mall passed away.
Night Court,
yeah. He played Bull, the big, tall, 6'8" bailiff on Night Court. He was 80 years of age. Well, isn't there some correlation to being really tall and not living as long?
Yes.
Yeah. I know there is with Great Danes, but
yep,
like Kierkegaard.
Same thing. Or Bjarne Riis. Same thing, though. The larger the body, the harder it has to work.
He was on Night Court for 9 seasons, ran from 1984 to 1992. Boy, that was a long time ago. So how many people on that Night Court cast are still alive? Because Harry Anderson passed away.
So did Marky Post.
Marky Post and Marsha Warfield is alive?
Let me look here. Yes, still alive.
Oh, okay. All right. So just, he's only the third, I guess, to pass away. His most notable later in life appearance was in the 2010 live-action film Scooby-Doo, Curse of the Lake Monster. Scooby-Doo.
Oh, yeah.
He played the mysterious lighthouse keeper, Elmer Uggins. Richard Mull passing away.
Scooby-Doo.
Somewhat of a sports note, Pete Sampras revealed that his wife, Bridget Wilson Sampras, has been diagnosed with ovarian cancer.
Oh, no.
She's only 50. Yeah. And apparently she was diagnosed in last December, but he just went public with this as their family's battling through that. She's gone through chemotherapy and other procedures. But, yeah, they got married in the year 2000. When did Corby and I play with? Because Pete Sampras is my doubles partner. The last time I played doubles tennis was with Pete Sampras.
It was like 15 years ago, something like that.
Okay, so they have two kids together, Christian and Ryan, and a 20-year-old and an 18-year-old. And Bridget Wilson Sampras was crowned Miss Teen USA in 1990. And is a former actress who has appeared in Saved by the Bell, Murder, She Wrote.
Murder.
Frasier, CSI Miami. She also starred in the film Billy Madison.
That was a great film.
Was it?
Yep.
Do we overrate Billy Madison?
Nope. All those Adam Sandler movies were funny.
We are all dumber for having heard. Billy Madison was the one with that famous.
Yeah.
When he tried to do the puppy speech and the guy who said, "I award you no points and may God have mercy on your soul." So she's battling ovarian cancer. And a notable sports death that we haven't had a chance to talk about, a very traumatic death that happened in England. A former NHL player, Adam Johnson, died when he was skating on the ice and got hit in the neck with an opponent's skate.
Oh, no.
And he gets knocked down. He tries to get back up and starts to skate off and then collapses. And he dies because his neck was cut by a skate.
Oh, my gosh.
Awful.
The worst. Who was that? Malarchuk? What's
Clint
his name?
Malarchuk. Goaltender that had his neck sliced by a skate. And
he survived.
Yeah.
And skated again. Didn't he keep playing?
Yep.
His career kept going? But if you sever that artery, I don't understand how you can live afterwards.
I know.
They must have gotten to Malarchuk very quickly. But they got to this guy quickly, and he didn't survive.
Mm-hmm. Terrible.
He played parts of two seasons with the Pittsburgh Penguins. This was his first season with the Nottingham Panthers. That was the team he was playing with. Only 29 years of age. And I know there's at least one team over there that says that all of their players are going to have to start wearing the protective neck shield thingy. There's some kind of
a good idea.
I would.
Kevlar wrap or something they can put on their necks to protect them. Man, I would too. Scare the hell damn out of me. Guys with those blades. How sharp are those blades? I've never felt.
They're pretty sharp. Are they
NHL
sharp
skates.
We used to have ours really sharp for the charity challenge.
Oh, yeah.
No, we didn't. We're going half a mile an hour. That's what's so crazy is I remember, I think I skated in one or two of those. I was mainly on the broadcast for most of our old charity challenge games where we would put on an exhibition hockey game for charity. But I remember skating and, you know, we practiced quite a bit for that thing and thinking, okay, my speed got up a little bit. I'm pretty happy with it.
No.
And then I watched the replay of it and everybody was moving so slowly on the ice.
I know.
Like even our fast guys.
Really bad hockey.
So horrible. So horrible. And another sports note for you. We've had another athlete that has been declared by Forbes a billionaire.
Still playing?
Can you name all four athletes that are on the Forbes list of billionaires? There's only four athletes that are billionaires.
Tiger.
Correct.
LeBron,
yes, correct.
Jordan,
correct.
And this one.
And then this new one that just made the list.
It's going to be. Is it Serena?
No.
Is it a woman?
No.
It's not a woman?
Mm-mm.
Michael Crabtree.
That is a terrible guess.
Brandon Aubrey.
Okay. You've given up.
Can you give me a hint? Hot what dog? Sport?
Yes, I can. I will tell you this. Here's my hint for you. This is a person that we all thought was going to be dead about 25 years ago. 30 years ago, actually.
Athlete.
Mm-hmm.
Dead.
Lawrence Taylor?
No, but we did think that about him, too.
Is it a fighter?
For a different reason. No, it isn't.
It's not Ed Belfour.
It's not Rodman.
I'm just going to tell you.
Really?
Magic Johnson.
Oh.
That makes sense now that he's
Yes.
You remember in the height of the AIDS
worry,
yeah,
you thought
and
that
he
was him
announced
saying,
that he
dying.
Had HIV, and that was like, that may be
Walker
the sports story that shocked me the most when I heard it.
Oh, yeah. It was November of 91.
Because he was still playing when that happened, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. He retired and then came back.
But he's been declared as the fourth athlete to ever turn into a billionaire. He's made, of course, incredibly impressive investments. In his career, he only made $40 million in his playing career. And today, now his estimated net worth is $1.2 billion.
Today he would be signing $300 million contracts.
Yeah.
5-year, $300 million contracts. But yeah, didn't he invest in movie theaters? And he's part owner of the Commanders?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he was a part owner in the Lakers, and he sold out a little too early in that.
Also,
because that would have been worth his stake in the Lakers would be worth $265 million today.
Wow.
Had he held on to it. But he sold in 2010, I think it was. But yeah, Craig, you mentioned the movie theaters. He has some fast food franchises. He's into real estate. And he's into insurance, health care and insurance, too. So it's life insurance. I think he also has a partnership with Starbucks. He owns more than 100 Starbucks in predominantly black neighborhoods in major U.S. cities. But, yeah, he is now worth $1.2 billion.
Good for him. Did he also own part of the Dodgers, or am I making that up? I think he did, yeah. Hmm. Always loved Magic.
Yeah.
Yeah, always personable. Mm-hmm. He had that show, though.
Yeah, that wasn't very good.
That wasn't his strength. But.
He did a talk show at one point. Tickets own Magic Johnson. Emerson in Arlington, you're on the ticket.
Hey, homos. When you fart, you release particles. But when you queef, do you shoot yeast?
Received some sort of spam call here.
Eli.
There's a lot offensive about that call.
Eli in San Antonio, you're on the ticket.
Hey, musers.
Hey, Chris.
Hey. It's Eli.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is George there?
I'm here.
Hey, George.
Hey.
Could you ask Junior who the Hot Fried Georgie player of the game is?
No way. We're going to do it again. We're going to give away the most prestigious weekly award in the NFL, the Hot Fried Georgie player of the game.
Well, I'm not going to ask him. I'm going to tell him based on what I saw.
Shut up. You hush.
Well, we have a lot of candidates this week, not the least of which, Cowboys quarterback Dak Prescott. He had an incredible game with 4 touchdown passes, 300 yards, looked really sharp. How about that defense? We had Micah Parsons several game-wrecking plays. Deron Bland with another pick six. A lot of guys on defense. Brandon Aubrey, 18 straight field goals made. Special teams, great too. But ladies and gentlemen, this week's winner of the Hot Fried Georgie Player of the Game is none of the aforementioned Cowboys. It is none other than that famous, handsome Cowboys wide receiver, Mr. CeeDee Lamb.
All right. CeeDee.
Congratulations, CeeDee Lamb. A career-high 12 catches, a career-high 158 yards, 2 touchdowns. He even ran it once for 12 yards. That's 12 yards per carry, which led all rushers yesterday. CeeDee Lamb is your Hot Fried Georgie player of the game.
He's been demanding the ball, and now that he got 12 receptions, I guess some people do listen to CDs.
Hello.
John. I liked it.
Just a what, Norm? What?
Hello.
Why does he always eat a buffet after he says a line?
Meat.
Let's go to Steven in Grand Prairie for instant reaction. Steven.
Wow, that was an impressive Hot Fried Georgie thingy player.
Hot fries.
Do you think that he won it because he stopped sniffing his finger finally?
No, yeah, he did that yesterday.
Did he?
Yeah.
Yeah, but there were a couple of times he didn't do it.
Yeah, he didn't do it every catch, but
he is he mixing in some different celebrations, or
maybe he knew he was going to get the ball a lot yesterday, so he didn't.
So he's tired of smelling his own finger.
Yeah.
What's that mean again? We've been told before.
First down?
Doesn't it mean something like I'm going to kill you?
No, I don't know. Yeah, means first down.
What is football?
Nick in Fort Worth, you're on with the Musers.
Hey, Musers, good morning.
Hey.
Hey, I was just wondering, can we go back to calling Tony Pollard the backup running back? He's way better in that role.
All right.
If we could just make him the backup, that'd be great.
Okay. Right. Yeah, well.
Maybe that would light a fire or something.
Pretty much our best friend, so.
Hey, Gordo, did you see that note? A couple P1s have messaged us.
Yeah.
The Clint Malarchuk having his jugular sliced by a skate, that the trainer for their team was a former combat medic in Vietnam and knew exactly what to do. He knew the second he saw it, and he went out there and knew how to stop the bleeding.
Okay, but what I don't get is after the Malarchuk incident, every medic on a hockey team knows that you're going to be faced with this possibly, so they ought to know the Vietnam tricks.
But they weren't trained in combat.
Well, you don't have to be trained in combat. You just have to be trained into how to pinch off the jugular, I don't know, whatever that is in your neck.
Pinch off the jugular.
Well, I'm not saying it's easy. I'm just saying that they ought to be well aware of that being a potential injury and how to treat it. They don't need Vietnam. I mean, am I wrong, guys? You know what I'm saying?
I can see where if you were a medic in combat, though, you'd be better at it than
when you see a guy that gets cut in the neck with a skate, don't you know immediately what you're supposed to do?
Yeah, but there's a certain way to do it, I would think, that would maybe be more effective.
Or maybe the normal NHL trainer would be freaked out by that, but the Vietnam vet, he's seen that a million times.
I hadn't seen it a million times.
Well, you
How
know
often
what I'm
are
saying.
People getting cut in the neck
he
with
does not
hockey skates in Vietnam.
Right. Well, not hockey skates. God.
You know what I'm saying, though?
You make every conversation a mess.
That's what he specializes
it's
in.
A very serious subject, though. I mean, you know what I'm saying?
Yes, it is. It is, and our thoughts are with Matthew Perry's family.
Yes.
You know well, that's a different one. That's a different story.
All right, Gordo, thank you. That's the corner.
Get the Steak Podcast at patreon.com/sportsgreek.
Once again, the ticket presents Why Today Doesn't Suck.
Lisa, it's your birthday. Happy birthday, Lisa. Lisa, it's your birthday.
Now, here are your hosts, Sean Bass and David Mino.
Thank you, Jerry. Thank you, DeMarcus Lawrence Ware. It's the sweet spot on a Victory Monday. Sean Bass, David Mino, and at 2:58, Matthew Birmingham.
Thank you, David Mino. Eatsy's Market and Bakery and Sante Center for Healing brings you Present Monty.
Thank you, Ham. Thank you, Lando, for not eating granola on our show.
You're welcome.
We appreciate that.
What did I miss?
Ugh.
I'm sure you'll hear it Friday.
Do we have the full clip, Ham?
Ugh.
This is just so Kaz chime in Kevin on the invasion, popping granola mid-HSO.
Walk on your back porch.
You wake up, there's a skunk in your house.
What if you have a McLaren situation where you can't get it closed?
Raccoon Lando.
I just like to imagine him like with a handful of popcorn, just popping one in between each sentence.
Dude, what are you doing?
I don't
He's
know.
The gif of Seinfeld. That's a shame.
I see him as a little raccoon with the food up his
mouth. Did he throw it up in the air and catch it in his mouth?
A little McLaren thing going on. Throws another one in his mouth.
Oh, that's great.
Was that before the call or after?
It was the same segment.
Oh, God.
What a 20 minutes that was.
That's where I'm getting my energy.
We'll have to put that to music.
Oh, yeah.
So we welcome in the hardline,
mm-hmm.
who is not on remote today, like I may have mentioned 30 minutes ago.
Well, they canceled it.
Oh.
Got a little chilly.
They postponed it.
Cold.
Postponed it.
Okay. Another date. So we have Corb, Dave.
Totes.
Dave.
And Bob.
Hey, Dad.
There's Bob. I can't see Bob.
It's a shame, Monty.
Good hair day?
That we're not in a spot where we can see each other. Yes, it's a good hair day. Thank you.
I'm saying I have a good hair day. I want you to look at it.
Yeah, let's see. You know what? You're right. Not bad.
I put extra Johnny Pomade in there today.
Looks really good.
I ran out of Dapper Dan.
Is that from the Manning line of quarter zips, Bob?
It's a Ranger one.
It's a Ranger quarter zip.
Okay.
Do you think that all that the Mannings wear are quarter zips?
Yeah, like, that's 100%.
It. Yeah.
That's it.
Like, Arch wants to wear something more up to date, but...
Do they ever not wear an undershirt? With their quarter zip? Who was doing that the other day?
Ted Cruz.
Ted Cruz, that's right.
Ted Cruz.
That was a Norm playbook.
Yeah, Maldonado jersey on.
Yeah, but I don't expect Norm to be familiar with quarter zips. They weren't around originally. Like, he was alive during the advent of the quarter zip.
They had barely invented zippers.
Yeah. Clothes.
Everything just used to be buttons.
Really barely integrated.
He used to be wearing flowing robes when he was born.
Garland.
Well, today is Monday, October 30th.
God bless
you. Sorry, Kevin. We're going to get on with the segment now. You can beat me. It's October 30th, the 303rd day of 2023. There are 62 days left in the year.
Whoa.
In 1938, the radio play The War of the Worlds, starring Orson Welles, played on CBS.
Oh, they're aliens attacking.
Heard only a portion of the broadcast, and intention, anxiety, pride of World War II, mistook it for a genuine news broadcast.
Yeah.
Started freaking out.
People were so dumb.
You would have done the same thing. You think you'd have been smarter?
Yeah, you would have
went smarter. If I tuned in and I heard a radio playlet about aliens
back then.
But you didn't know. Okay.
Like when we do Dawson's Creek promos, people are like, check out that show.
That sounds like a good show.
You cure AIDS with AIDS.
You need to give the people a little bit of a break from the 30s.
The most educated person they knew had graduated fourth grade.
Right.
Let me turn on the other channel to see if this is a real story.
Well, they're not covering that as much as I thought they would.
I guess it's fake news.
Dude, H.G. Wells was 23 at the time.
He wrote War of the Worlds at 22, 23?
I guess
He's the hot name now around Valley Ranch.
Sure was. And it was Orson Welles.
Yeah, not H.G.
Who had the voice of God.
Orson.
David Welles.
Horson.
Of course.
He was part man, part horse.
Vernon Welles.
In 1945.
Shut up, Bob.
The U.S. government announces the end of shoe rationing, which had been implemented 18 months prior due to the rubber shortage.
You want
to
get on him for that, too?
Why they just go down to Foot Locker?
Go get another one, dude. Foot Action's open 24/7.
Still
just
get it.
Punch it up on Prime next day. What's the deal?
Pay $2.99, get it overnighted. People were allowed to buy one pair of shoes per year. To get a new pair, a man had to apply to the local ration board, prove he needed the shoes for essential industry, not for sport, and turn in his old pair.
It's a better time.
Man, I'd have been like, yeah. I just keep wearing these old ones. Sounds like a lot of work.
I would like to apply for new shoes.
I gotta fill out this paperwork all the way up there.
Why didn't they just order from East Bay?
Did they ever keep them new in box?
Oh, it was like a collector's item?
Yeah.
Those might go for a lot now.
Some nice colorways.
Yeah, I don't know if they had J's back then. On October 30th, 1974, Muhammad Ali knocked out George Foreman, the dad, in the eighth round of a 15-round bout in Kinshasa, Zaire, known as the Rumble in the Jungle.
Down goes Frazier.
That must have been a really cool time to be, like, into that sport. Like, in the 70s, I get it, Tyson was cool too, but I mean, that had to have been... I remember my dad going to see those closed circuit fights, and I'm like, God, that would be so cool if I could go with you.
Imagine all the smoking and
those places. Yes.
Hell yeah.
All the fringe racism.
That's what you mean. Men were men.
I don't know if it's fringe.
As you cheer against the races you least enjoy.
Yeah, but if it's
you don't really have a choice. But I would imagine most of the men that were born around 1920 were a little anti-Ali.
Yeah, so then you just had to choose between George or Muhammad.
That is the most popular name in the world, though.
One name?
Yeah, read a book.
One name? Who are you, Seal?
All right, big day for women, October 30th. As in 1996, the WNBA announces the 8 cities that will compete in the WNBA's inaugural season.
All right, let's guess.
Yeah, what's the original 8 in the WNBA?
Puerto Rico.
New York Liberty. All right, New York
Tempe.
Is on there. No, not Tempe.
Lincoln.
Cleveland Rockers.
L.A. Sparks.
Bossier City.
L.A. You're making bad city guesses.
Mercury.
Richardson.
Bossier City.
Charlotte, Cleveland, Houston, New
Round
York.
Round Rock.
LA, Bossier Phoenix, City, Sacramento, Boats. And
Rockford Peaches.
Yay!
There you go.
So for that whole year, women were like, dude, things are coming up us.
The Rockford Peaches is a good guess, Lando.
Thank you.
Yeah, you deserve some granola.
Yeah, get another hit in your granola bag.
Snort some.
I'm just going to give Lando a feed sack.
I'm going to give him a horse and a feed bag.
He's got his head in there.
Going nuts.
You only take it off for ticker, sir.
Trying to get that fly away.
So, if women Yeah, I'll give him a sugar cube when he finishes all his hay.
Maybe brush him.
So if women thought they had a good 96, let's go to 97 now.
Put a nice blanket on him. Jeez.
As Violet Palmer makes pro sports history by becoming the first woman to officiate an NBA game. And then this little added note, which is totally unnecessary.
First official in the NBA to queef during an NBA game.
Yeah, that's probably right.
It probably was her.
Dave.
But the added note was, there was little reaction by the crowd when her name was announced just before tip-off of the game between the Mavs and Grizzlies.
Oh.
So they're like, ladies and gentlemen, Violet Palmer!
And who's playing tonight?
Mavs and Grizzlies.
Yes.
There was more applause for the queen.
Yeah, all the ladies in the stands just let me
right when she threw it up for the opening tip.
They have the decibel meter.
Yeah, the crowd noise meter just starts banging.
So to speak.
It raised Reunion Arena by a foot and a half. And in 2012...
Mark Cuban's like, I'm buying this team.
That's when Cynthia had to come in. In 2012, the Walt Disney Company announced it would buy Lucasfilm for $4.05 billion, paving the way for a new Star Wars trilogy.
He literally, in hindsight, gave it away. Like, they made that money up after, like, two movies. He's probably like, oh, well.
Legend.
They made yes, Ty, legend. Action figures, probably.
By the way, do you think that would have been a funny press conference if Cent Marshall, in her very first one, had to address queefing, like, over and over?
We're not going to... I know that's our big deal, but we're going to get rid of that tradition in 2018. Yeah.
And Cuban standing to the side, like, bobbing his head up and down, like, it was terrible.
Never had to rig up...
Pointing at her.
So many queefs.
Never another queef mic after that for press conferences. Okay. All right, P1 birthdays today. MontyWTDS@gmail.com. Hey, Monty. Love the new midday lineup. Been listening for 20 years. Don't go a day without it. Shout out to my youngest son, Jeremiah. He just turned 20. I'm sure he doesn't listen, but it's still good. How about a long fart with a Corbygasm in the background? Love you guys. Go Rangers, from Jared.
What is considered a long fart?
It's like a long...
Like, how long does it... That's a long fart.
Oh, I was going to say, like, 4 seconds.
The stepbrothers,
One is...
Oh, my God.
Numero uno.
You got to have a couple syllables.
It'd have to be pretty long if I do the Corby after, though.
Yeah.
Also, P1 Ron turning 43 today. Leaders are the rant. Drop request. Something funny from Davey. But we can play a drop, or Davey could just...
Dave!
See, there's nothing.
keep looking.
Scanning the audio
wheel,
files.
Rainbow wheel.
See nothing.
All right, birthdays today.
I'm disappointed Max Scherzer didn't hand fart when he was on with you guys.
I know.
I challenged Max Scherzer to a hand fart off. I think I could get him.
He thought about it, and then he was just like, nah, I can't.
Maybe he'll do it on the bus.
How did we get into hand farting?
That was question number one.
He was nursing it.
So, you fart with your hands?
Don't you weird
do with your eyes, man.
Whoa, you're freaking me out.
He was hitting it off with Killer. Things were all really weird that day.
All right, I'll stop.
All right, singer Otis Williams of The Temptations is 82.
Otis.
Henry Winkler, 78.
Dude, Fonz. So good in Barry.
Gene Cousineau.
Bravo, Barry. Bravo.
Andrea Mitchell, 77. Drummer of AC/DC, Chris Slade, 77 also. Timothy B. Schmidt, bassist of the Eagles, 76. Larry Wilmore, 62.
Oh, I know this guy. Black dude.
The lead singer of Bush, Gavin Rossdale, 58.
Breathe in, breathe out. Gwen Stefani's baby daddy.
Breathe out, breathe in. That's what made the hardline hit it off was... Like, what are we going to do from 57 from now on?
Our pentatonics view of Bush...
And yeah, we were
Penta Bush.
Yeah. Please give us Penta Bush and ticket stock.
Bush Atonics.
Breathe in, breathe out.
Acapella. All right, Bob, well, can we do...
Just do all the parts.
Whatever that song is. Breathe
machine
in, breathe
head.
Yeah, Machine Head. Can yeah. we do that?
Just
you
go,
can't sing.
No, yeah.
It's just the breathe instruments.
You just go full Bush.
Yeah.
That's a good yeah. song, man. Bring that song
full
back.
Full Bush at ticket stock. Yeah.
Oh, Bob got kicked in the head again.
You're flossing the whole time. Tori Belleci, 53. He's the other white guy from Mythbusters. So you have the two main ones, and then you have those three minions. One was Asian, one was a woman, and then Tori. Cash anyway. Cab host Ben Bailey, 53.
He ran over a guy.
Covers the Bengals.
Look it up.
Ham.
I see the feed sack is off.
Yeah, he unstrapped his feed bag for that liner. Ivanka Trump, 42.
Wait, who's the dead one?
Oh, jeez.
Wasn't there a dead Ivana. One he buried in a bunker or something?
Ivana.
Oh, that's his daughter.
Yeah, Ivanka's the daughter.
Yeah, that's the one he was...
He wanted to have sex with.
Yeah, still does.
He buried the other one in a bunker, and he wanted to have sex with that one. Okay, now I get it. Yeah,
I thought you had to bury that one in a piano case.
No. That was the Guinness Book of World Records guy.
Brett Kelly is 30. That's Thurman Merman from Bad Santa.
What's he up to?
Not the Channel 11 photog?
I think he's in porn now.
Yeah.
Is that the same
important.
Guy?
That Brett great. Kelly is more important.
Yeah.
I got a birthday, Monto.
Okay, Corby.
Today is the birthday of, I got to get this name straight, Julie Davidson.
Whoa!
That's why same last name. Pin on your nose.
That's a lot of effing baseball.
I wish she talked like that.
I know it. Here
that's
you
a
go.
Lot of baseball. Baseball?
She tried to, Bob was quizzing her the other night. She came over to our remote. And Bob was like, we need more baseball, Julie. She's like, can I clarify myself? And he was like, no, we don't need that.
No, don't change.
You like it the way it is.
I want you to be the most anti-baseball person
baseball?
In the Metroplex.
Well, happy birthday.
Happy birthday. Yeah, Julie.
Dick Vermeil's 87.
Forever.
And holding.
Is she, is she geared up for game 3 for her birthday party?
Yeah.
Watching party?
Does she know who's starting tonight? Does she know anyone who is starting?
Let's start with the team.
1-9, anybody?
No. Well, she might be.
Cold call.
Does she think Adolis Garcia is hot?
Did you wake her up in that special way?
No, because she wasn't there.
Will Adolis replace LeVar Arrington?
Does she want Adolis to screw in that light bulb?
Did I wake her up in that special way?
So to speak.
888.
Yeah.
It's Adolis and Chapman.
I'm trying to think. There's no way that she's going to know one person. Although, she's kind of getting into the bullpen of the Diamondbacks, so maybe she'll know a few of those.
Hey.
Like Paul Sewald.
Yeah, she was huge on that Seattle trade for Sewald.
Just love Andrew.
She's always been a big Ginkle guy.
Wait, Ginkle and what's his...
Thompson?
No, the other guy that had the name Mantiply.
Oh, yeah, man. Those lefties.
Which I said he should pronounce it Mantiply.
She has a
those
kink.
Are look.
She has a kink. Kink.
Think that two names, back-to-back pitchers, Mantiply and Ginkle... Have you ever heard of those names ever?
No.
Mantiply. That's very Keen's we were saying Mantiply is like a lesser DC villain.
Yeah.
I think Selfrank is the best name. Because it sounds like a first and last
name. Selfrank is there
too. Andrew Selfrank.
Yeah.
Hey. He's a man. He can multiply. He's Mantiply.
He's right.
Yeah.
All right. Quinn Snyder, 57.
He turns into a locust when he's mad.
Moderation.
All the cocaine. Edge is 50.
Oh, Ty.
That's been around for a long time, apparently. Oh.
Legend.
Lance Nix, 43.
Oh, give it to me, Lance.
It's a song.
Push.
Is that Nastia Lukin?
No.
Nastia Lukin, the gymnast, 34. I met her at a kid cancer event one time.
Now, did she have cancer?
What a brag.
No. She just, like, did a pommel horse routine for us.
That's what I was going to say. Like, what? Hey, go do those rings.
Hey, go bang your loins all Ham? Over that.
Yeah. Go do a cartwheel.
Young Justin just needs a minute.
Excuse me, I'll be in the bathroom.
Did you smell the pommel horse?
I bought it in the auction.
Smell.
I tried to clean it.
No, Justin, we're not allowed to smell the pommel horse.
I paid good money for the pommel horse.
Back away from the pommel horse.
I'm
going to
die soon. 27.
Smell what I want.
I need this.
Yeah. Just pouring cocaine on her crotch pommel.
Happy birthday, Nastia.
Happy birthday. She's from here, so who knows. Let's go. Diego Maradona died.
Bye, Justin.
Bye, David.
Broadcasting live from the TXU Energy.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, Bob.
Our star, Dave.
Speaking of Friday.
Hi, Dave.
Hello. Speaking of Friday, as we've said on this show before, we don't do this for them. We do it for us. But if you're curious, Game 1 of Rangers Diamondbacks was the least watched World Series ever.
Ever.
It drew 9.17 million viewers for Fox, which is less than the pandemic series in 2020.
Well, at least we were almost as good as a disease-ridden series.
With no fans in the stands.
Right.
Which was also played at the GILF.
That's right.
All right.
We probably shouldn't cover it then.
Yeah, we'll just blow it off for the rest of the show.
No.
Oh, no. Dave?
Clear.
Are you feeling better? Is the SoFi flu gone? It's just the residual effects?
Well, I passed Corby's SoFi AIDS to my wife, so she now has it.
So now the baby's got it.
Oh,
yeah. Way to go, Corby.
Go, Dave. And so, yeah, I'm more or less over it. I just have the congestion won't go away.
Yeah.
So Matthew Perry, sorry, I apologize for how awful I sound. More awful than usual.
You sound great.
Matthew Perry tributes are pouring in from around the globe. All of his former co-stars, whether they are regular Friends co-stars or guest stars.
How did y'all find out?
I think I saw it on Twitter, just in the middle of the day on Saturday.
No, it was late.
Oh, was it late Saturday?
Oh, yeah, it was.
I can't remember.
During the World Series game.
It was just after first pitch is when I heard.
Okay, yeah, yeah. But yeah, I first saw it on Twitter.
I couldn't believe it. We were up in Kansas with just me and my kids, and my kids are Friends Super P1s, and we're sitting there playing pool and darts at the hotel bar with the game on. And somebody sent me that TMZ thing.
Yeah.
And I was just like, oh my, I didn't even know how to tell them. They've had zero deaths. Anybody that dies, like, yeah, whatever, because they're old and stupid. Like, this affected them more than, like, their grandparents.
Yeah.
I mean, it was like, what? Dude, it's impactful. It is globally impactful.
Well, and
Lisa called me.
Lisa.
Kudrow.
Okay.
She wanted me to know. She wanted me to hear it from.
So, yeah, for like a decade, it was on Netflix.
You died.
And generated a whole new generation of fans on Netflix. And then it has moved to Max. And so on Max, they have already added a slide to start each episode that says, in memory of Matthew Perry, 1969-2023. And it's held up there for 5 seconds before the Friends opening theme. It's kind of incongruent to go to Happy Dancing in the Fountain after seeing his death date.
Do you think that his friends, and no pun intended, people that, and I'm not talking about like the people on the show because they're not like, you know, super tight, hanging out all the time together.
Like Lisa.
Like your friend Lisa.
But his good friends, do you think that this was, they were waiting on this moment? Not to be dark, but like they knew this could be at any moment.
I mean, I think
welcome
they...
Welcome in, Gilbrandt.
I think they probably were hoping that he had turned the corner and that fear maybe had dissipated a bit. But when you have somebody that has that history, you just don't know.
Like the book that he wrote, his memoir, which is back to number one, oddly enough, talked about his close calls with death,
yeah,
like how he escaped and his colon exploded one time because he was taking so many pills.
Oh, yeah, yeah, because the opioids will constipate you.
Yeah.
And he got so blocked up that it just
colon
exploded on the inside of his body. Just doo-doo everywhere in his midsection.
That's what the doctor came out and told his family.
There's doo-doo everywhere.
I'm afraid he has doo-doo everywhere.
He comes out with just his hands covered in blood and feces.
I'm sorry, but there was doo-doo everywhere. What?
So, yeah, the L.A. What? County Medical Examiner's Office has confirmed that foul play is not suspected. He did die of drowning in his hot tub, which was a giant hot tub. I don't know if you saw pictures of his place out in L.A.
Oh, he's a friend. He's got money.
Yeah. I mean, so he had a house that was overlooking the Hollywood Hills, and imagine it was probably like an infinity pool, but he had a giant, looked like a 30-person hot tub. It's not just a little...
Well, so it's like a pool.
Well, I mean, it was a hot tub.
Right.
Separate from the pool.
But it's massive. I've never seen one like that.
Yeah, it was gigantic.
It was like a diving board.
Yeah.
And so
ladder.
When you picture somebody, when you hear drowned in a hot tub, you picture like the little round hot tub
that
seats like four people at your parents' pool.
Right.
That we all have. Plus funny.
Yeah, so they say foul play is not suspected, but they do need to do a toxicology report, so that may not be back for a couple weeks.
Let me just go ahead and tell everyone, it's not going to be real positive. You don't drown.
It was in the middle of the day. It was in the middle of the day.
Yeah.
Okay, here's the thing. Here's the thing.
And now.
So are you betting that there's nothing in his system?
Here's the deal.
No, just let me do E-News.
Get him.
Go ahead, Dave.
So
you'll feel better if you call him a bad name,
right?
And then we don't.
Well, I was about to say Rick with a P.
Yeah,
but I knew it would get dumped, and I didn't. Mm-hmm. I didn't. I don't play dump and chase.
No,
that's not how I play.
You shouldn't.
So he had played pickleball at the very exclusive Rivera Country Club.
Riviera.
Huh. It's spelled Rivera here.
It's Riviera, right?
I don't know.
Yeah, I believe you're right, but I also would like to.
Well, there's
the jury to note that there was pickleball at the most exclusive country club.
Well, Matthew Perry's not going to play it out in the park.
There is a typo in this story if it is Riviera.
Okay.
But yes, he played pickleball at the country club mm-hmm. for 2 hours before his death. He came back home.
At Riv.
He asked his assistant to go pick up some prescription eyeglasses and a new iPhone.
Uh-huh.
2 hours later, the assistant came back and found him unresponsive in the jacuzzi. So,
gosh, you can have an assistant go get your new phone?
Right? Yeah. How is that possible?
That sounds amazing.
Yeah, you just send them on their way.
They just paid cash. You didn't have to worry about filling out the activation paperwork.
Amazing.
And so... When authorities did a sweep of the property, they did find prescription drugs in the home. There were no illegal drugs,
mm-hmm.
but they found antidepressants and anxiety drugs and COPD medication, because he had breathing problems from years of smoking. But none of that seems out of the ordinary. So it will be interesting to see if he OD'd or was, maybe had too much in his system and then passed out. But... you know, I heard them speculating on the musers that maybe he slipped and fell.
Could have.
You just don't know.
I just like the fact that the most quotes we are seeing involved in this horrible tragedy are from the pickleball coach.
Yes. Matt Manassi is his pickleball coach. And yes, it is.
That's the best we could do.
It is Riviera. This story has it spelled correctly. But yes, he was his pickleball coach at Riviera Country Club. And so Manassi said that Matthew Perry was using pickleball to keep him away from drugs. Mm-hmm. That he would play 5 times a week and that he was competitive, but not in a bad way. He loved it. When he would hit an unbelievable shot, he would let you know about it for days.
That's all we do. That's just what we do.
In the pickleball community.
Yeah, we'll let you know.
When is the... candlelight vigil
at Lakewood for Matthew Perry at the pickleball courts.
All right, I'm going to try and organize that.
And they leave one court open.
Always.
For Matthew.
Always.
I want to hear about...
missing doubles formation.
I want to hear about... He would let you know about the one shot he hit for days.
What a jerk.
What a moron. Dude, remember last Tuesday?
Yeah.
Gotcha. Remember that drop shot?
Right up the alley, bro. I'll never forget.
Gotcha.
Oh!
Gotcha, deuce.
All right. The Rolling Stones have set a record. So Hackney Diamonds, their 38th album to chart in the top 10. That is a record. It really just extends their record because they already had the record at 37. So behind them, Barbra Streisand with 34 and the Beatles and Frank Sinatra with 32. But the Rolling Stones have become the first ever act to have a top 10 album in the Billboard 200 chart in each decade since the 60s. Hackney Diamonds debuted at number 3 on the most recent edition. So they've had a top 10 record in the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, aughts, 10s, and 20s.
So on my my travels this weekend to the Great Plains of the United States, I had time for the very first time to consume that album.
Yeah? Thoughts?
So I had read that it's the best reviewed album that they've had in 40 years, I think since Tattoo U.
Uh-huh.
Oh!
So right now would be the time to play the cut you always play, Ham. When I say Tattoo You from the Rolling Stones. Yeah, there you go. There's Tattoo You.
Yeah.
So I'd read that. I'm like, okay. I cannot tell you how good this record is compared to everything they've done in the last 30 years.
I believe it.
Dude.
Most of what they put out is trash.
It's crazy good, especially considering that they are 80.
Yeah. All right, I'll give it a listen.
I'll present it.
Okay, we have a few things I want to get to them now. Five Nights at Freddy's. We had talked about how it did so great in the previews.
Mm-hmm.
It shattered even the loftiest expectations. Five Nights at Freddy's debuted with 80 million in North America,
dude.
132 million globally.
And this was a
$20 million?
Oh my God. And it's about the Chuck E. Cheese animatronic band going on a murder spree.
Yeah, it's based on a video game franchise that evidently has an enormous following that I wasn't aware of. But it's already surpassed the entire global haul of Halloween Ends from 2022, which was 104 million, and Halloween Kills in 2021, 133 million. It is, after one weekend, it is about to catch The Nun 2 at 85 million, Megan at 95 million, and Scream 6 at 108 million as the highest grossing horror film of the year. It'll pass that this weekend. Audience score is an A-. Rotten Tomatoes score from the critics is 25%. So
yeah.
wide variety there. But it also, because it dropped on Peacock the same weekend, last weekend, it's already the most watched and biggest subscription driver on Peacock.
Wow. And Killers of the Flower Moon made $15 million or something like that?
Yeah, I don't have that number, but yeah, probably meh. All right, another quick hit. The Simpsons had another premonition last night. So this was episode 4 of season 35.
Oh, my God.
And so they've made a lot of predictions over the years. They predicted Ebola. They predicted a Game of Thrones plot point at some point.
Trump is president,
yes. And so in the episode last night called Thirst Trap, A Corporate Love Story, there was a young college dropout voiced by Elizabeth Banks who ends up charming Mr. Burns into getting married and funding her dream project. And so at one point in the episode, he gives her a little something special for her birthday and gives her a card. And she says, a Twitter gift card? And he says, no, I bought you Twitter, the whole company. It was a bargain. The previous owner had to sell it after his self-driving Mars rocket crashed into the International Space Station. So he predicted Elon's demise.
Okay, so it's
It's not a prediction that came true. It's just a prediction that's out there.
It's a prediction that we need to wait for to see if Elon tries to launch himself to Mars and destroys the International Space Station.
All right. I love it. I'm here for it.
All right. And we don't have time for Flavor Flav performing the national anthem at the Bucks game last night. He is now a Bucks buddy. But I swear to God, it is the longest national anthem in the history of national anthems.
You got to get a hold of this, Bob. I don't know if I continue to be.
It was sent to me about 40 times.
Yeah, maybe we need to review it in Bob's world. Yeah, because it'll take the whole
Bob's
segment.
World. All right, good stuff, David.
And here is Dave.
All right, so Everman, not Everton, but Everman. It's a tiny city in Tarrant County, about 6,000 people. It's about 30 miles southwest of Dallas.
A small private school in the Midwest.
Close.
And there's been a story that we have not necessarily touched in Community Quick Hits, but it has been in the headlines if you've watched the news, read the news locally over the past year, that has been at the top of a lot of people's radar. So a little boy, 6 years old, Noel Rodriguez Alvarez, he was last seen a year ago. He wasn't reported missing until last March, or this March.
That's a little weird.
Yeah. The fact that...
What are you thinking? He'll turn up?
Yeah, that no one had seen him since a year ago, but it took them like 6 months to report him missing.
File a report.
Yeah. A body has not yet been found. They still don't know where he is, but... He is presumed dead, authorities announced in April after weeks of searching for him with the assistance of the FBI and Homeland Security. They could not find him, and so he is presumed dead. Well, today, the mother of Noel Rodriguez Alvarez was indicted on 4 counts, including capital murder.
Mm-hmm.
The other 2 counts, or the other 3 counts, 1 count of abandoning a child without the intent to return, and 2 counts of injury to a child. And so, now here's the thing, is that the mother, the stepfather, and the siblings went through TSA security on March 22nd and jumped on a flight to Istanbul via Turkish Airlines. And they ended up in India, the stepfather's home country. So now police are working with federal agencies to try and extradite them back to the U.S. to face these charges.
Oh, boy.
Wow. Yeah. So a wild story. And
I would say that anytime parents wait 6 months to report a child missing, that there are red flags.
Yes. Lots of red flags.
Within the family.
Lots of red flags. Okay, in case you hadn't noticed, we had a cold front blow through over the weekend. It is balls cold out there right now. As a matter of fact...
Yeah. I mean, dude, Friday when we were out at the game, it felt 87 degrees.
It was a peach of a day.
Well, as a matter of fact, tonight, North Texas is under our first freeze warning of the year, or of the season.
Let's go.
Temperatures are projected to drop into the upper 20s tonight, and they won't rise above freezing until after 10 a.m. in the morning. And this is early for our first freeze of the winter, right, as generally November 22nd is the average first freeze for DFW.
So we have a longer Indian summer in which it stays 95 or whatever.
How?
And then now we're getting quicker freezes.
Yeah, we had no fall whatsoever. It was just summer, then winter.
Now, it is supposed to go back to what is considered fall. Let's see here. I'll tell you right now on the ticket. So, yes, in the 30s as lows, but by Thursday, the highs are back up to 62, and then 71, 76, 77, 78, 68, 79. So... it's back to normal. High, lows in the 50s or whatever. This is just an odd cold spell. But how about the basic foot of rain we got over the course of the last week to get us out of a drought in a week?
Yeah. I had a lake in my backyard for a while. But yeah, it's great that we got some rain. There were isolated reports of flash flooding, but for the most part, everybody came out unscathed. from the rain.
Yeah.
It was just a healthy dumping of rain. And so now we have to weather the early freeze tonight, wrap your pipes outside, and then tomorrow, Halloween, precipitation is going to dry up, but it is going to clear up, and it's just going to be chilly. It's going to be a little bit warmer, but the high tomorrow is supposed to be around 56, and it'll feel like, because it'll be a little windy during trick-or-treating hours, it'll feel like it's in the upper 40s. So bundle up if you're taking your kiddos out tomorrow.
Trick-or-treat before first pitch.
Yeah, you're going to have to try and convince the kids to trick-or-treat when it's still light outside.
Do you think that the kids are really concerned tomorrow
about
night
first pitch?
About first pitch time?
Who cares?
Pitch,
I am.
On first pitch, we activate the catapult front porch. So... if you hit the doorbell, the catapult will launch you two
or
streets
one
over.
One of those boxing gloves. It just knocks out like a wave of kids.
Yes.
Ham, I...
Or the bowl of, please, take one.
Right. Just one, honest children. I cannot wait for Ham to impregnate Lady Ham.
Hey, now.
Why?
Because I just can't. I'm ready for it. For this, who cares what they think. It's what I care about. I'm
turtle
ready for that.
I want baseball.
Turtle dove.
Yeah.
Is it okay if
well,
I
it's going to work out. Dove. It's going to work out because he and his child will have the same exact diet.
It'll be awesome.
They'll be best friends.
Chocolate forever. Milk for everyone.
Is it okay if I were to watch some baseball tonight?
So tomorrow we have the...
I've cleaned up my space...
We have the 18th birthday of... Oh, hang
you
on,
think
Bob.
I care?
Hang
you
on,
just
Bob.
Made me happy.
We have the 18th birthday of my oldest.
Oh, wow. Is he a Halloween baby?
Halloween baby. Yep. 420 on Halloween. Man.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
He's like a stoned demon.
Right. Pretty much. But yeah, and so he's like, I want to go to dinner. It's my 18th birthday. And I'm like...
Cool. You should.
Here's some McDonald's gift cards. Yeah. Like, what do you want? What do you want from me?
Here's a DQ gift card.
So yeah, we'll be going somewhere tomorrow, and I'll have to come home and try to catch up on the game.
I love catch up.
You proved on Friday that you don't care about baseball.
I proved that I care about my family, Dave. That's all I care about.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
Yay.
Uh-huh. By the way, for those of those P1s who think that Bob and I, they're lumping us in the same boat as Corby.
See, I thought you were going to support him, but you're going to distance more
no,
from him.
No, there's okay. For those that say that we didn't deserve to be there because we were making a strategic move for our exit, it was also a strategic move for our enjoyment, because while Randy and the crew in the suite was great,
right,
it definitely felt detached from the action, and we wanted to be with the people.
Well, and honestly, I just think it's important for everybody at the end of eight, if you're behind, you've got to change it up. Now, that might mean running to your closet and changing shirts. It might mean if you're on the couch, you switch to a chair, but it definitely means if you're in a luxury suite and you're full of great food anyway, go somewhere else. Try to change the karma.
Totally yeah. agree.
And I
like your car.
And during the
yeah, maybe get in your car.
And during the Adolis at bat, I went hat backwards.
Oh, you did,
and it worked. Rally hat worked. Now powder blue, Rangers Sunday blue did not work on Saturday, so it has been retired.
Yeah, City Connect has not been working for me. That's also been retired.
Yeah, so powder blue, during I think the eighth or ninth inning, as I was watching the final innings in bed, got thrown across the room.
Okay, and I think, and I don't want to speak for everyone here, but I think at least Corby and I are back in our Game 1
yes.
outfits.
Unwashed.
And let me tell you, if they win tonight, you're going to see a lot of this quarter zip for the rest of the week. I'm just going to stay in it all week long.
Well, I have switched to the royal blue World Series hat that was purchased at Rally House last Thursday.
So we'll see
what kind of mojo this hat can bring. And if you are a Rangers super fan, if you would love to be in the building, but you can't afford to be in the building for a home game.
You're speaking to me.
You can be in the building for games 3, 4, or 5 tonight, tomorrow, or Wednesday, as they will have a watching party. They will open the doors of Globe Life Field. $10 to get in, free to park in lots B, lots R, and lot Q.
Ham, go!
I might do it.
Seriously.
Yeah. Not tonight, but later.
Yeah, so the gates open at 6, and of course, first pitch is just after 7 each night. So yeah, if you can't make it tonight, make plans Halloween or Wednesday night to go party with your fellow Ranger fans at the ballpark.
I'll let you count this as your first World Series moment.
You know what they should do?
Thank you.
You know what they should do? They should let people simulate the Rangers. And so I would love to get Ham as, say, Corey Seager. And so in the bottom of innings, he would go out to shortstop and just stand there.
So it's like rotisserie baseball,
yes,
where you move the figures around.
And so if Seager goes to first, then Ham goes and stands on first, and then all the people there can kind of get their mind's eye of not only the screen, but also they can look down and see where all their favorite Rangers are.
Do you think if Ham was in right field for the Corey Seager home run in the upper deck and he wasn't really paying attention, would that ball have gone through his throat out the other side, like a predator style, ripping the spinal cord completely out?
And would you have been willing to sacrifice Ham to get game one?
Yes.
Ham, would you be willing to sacrifice
yourself?
Okay.
Would you give yourself as tribute?
I would.
He would die for the Rangers.
That's commitment.
We'll save it for like game 5.
Yeah, not now.
A pivotal game 5.
And that is Community Quick Hits.
So we're burning Ham at a funeral pyre. Alive.
Shooting a lit tendy into his raft.
Yeah, some Game of Thrones scene.
You know what? At the Ranger Parade, we would have a Ham float.
We would.
To commemorate your sacrifice.
We would. We'll have to find somebody else to get your wife pregnant.
On it.
Oh, perfect. DJ.
See, everybody's helping.